morning. Good morning. Welcome to St. Gregory's Church. My name is Mother Liz. It's a joy to worship with you on this Feast of the Transfiguration. Everything you need for the service can be found in three books, the Book of Common Prayer, and then the two music, the music notebook, as well as the hymnal in front of you. Our service begins on page 355 in the Book of Common Prayer. Page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who on the holy mount revealed to chosen witnesses your well-beloved Son, wonderfully transfigured in raiment white and glistening, mercifully grant that we, being delivered from the disquietude of this world, may by faith behold the King in his beauty, who with you, O Father, and you, O Holy Spirit, lives and reigns one God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the lessons.
The first lesson is a reading from Exodus, chapter 34. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin on his face shone because he'd been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin on his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin on his face was shining. And Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord. Please read with me Psalm 99 in your leaflet. The Lord is King, let the people tremble. He is enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth shake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is high above all peoples. Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome. He is the Holy One. O mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One. Moses and Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among those who call upon his name, they called upon the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies and the decree that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them indeed. You were a God who forgave them, yet punished them for their evil deeds. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and worship him upon his holy hill. For the Lord our God is the Holy One.
Today's second lesson is a reading from the second book of Peter. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to refresh your memory, since I know that my death will come soon, as indeed our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure, you may be able at any time to recall these things, for we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rise in your heart. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women, moved by the Holy Spirit, spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now about 8 days after Jesus had foretold his death and resurrection, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now, Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my Son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord. Today the church celebrates the Feast of the Transfiguration. On this day, Jesus hiked up to the mountaintop with James, John, and Peter to pray. While in prayer on the mountaintop, Jesus was transfigured. Luke's gospel says that the appearance of his face changed, and Mark and Matthew's gospel add his face shone like the sun. Matthew's gospel tells us that Jesus' clothes became a dazzling white as the light. And Mark's gospel adds, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. Now that would be Alter Guild's dream. Heavy with sleep, James, John, and Peter managed to stay awake to witness this fantastic event. As our collect of the day puts it, they are delivered from the disquietude of their world so they can behold the King and his beauty. Unlike in the Garden of Gethsemane, where the same disciples will fall asleep, here on this mountaintop, they will be awake to see Jesus in his glory. The disciples stay awake to see Elijah and Moses in their glory. Their presence is packed with meaning. Moses symbolizes that Jesus is the completion of the law, and Elijah signals that Jesus is the fulfillment of the prophets. And if these two men, these two prophets of the Hebrew Bible's presence from the dead were not enough, there comes a cloud that just swallows them and is all around them, and they hear from this cloud God's voice that affirms Jesus' identity as God's beloved Son. I love the Greek Orthodox icon of the Transfiguration. As you came in or as you go out, you'll notice it's at the left of the narthex, so I commend it to you as you leave. We'll also post it on social media. This particular icon was had some commentary by the late Archbishop Rowan Williams. And Rowan Williams, he wrote this book on dwelling in the light, praying with icons. It's a fantastic book that I commend to you. And in this particular meditation on the Transfiguration, Rowan Williams talks about the disciples, and he gives some commentary on the disciples and how they're in the foreground, and one of them actually is shielding their eyes, another of the disciples are looking away because Jesus' glory is just too much to bear. Blinded by the light of God that illuminates Jesus, they have to shield their eyes. It's just all too much to take in. And I think that this same experience can be true for our own lives of faith. Amid the disquietude of our world, the possibility that the Transfiguration ignites can seem almost too much to imagine. The transfigured Christ offers us a glimpse into God's original vision for humanity, that we were meant for glory. We were meant to shine. Before sin and death entered into the world, humanity was and is meant for flourishing in God's light. What's more, the transfigured Christ serves as a window into what our bodily restoration will look like in the age to come. The Transfiguration is a reminder to us who have not yet gone home to be with the Lord what our own resurrection will look like. The Transfiguration reminds us of what is being made possible in our own creation in this age, as well as the age to come. When we pray, we may not think about praying for our own transfiguration. We may not think about praying to be drenched in God's glory, to awaken a vision prayer, illuminated by God's light, would freak most of us out. But we actually pray for our own transformation every time we celebrate the Eucharist. Every time the priest prepares the chalice, they pray, "By the mixing of this water and wine, may we come to share in Christ's divinity, who humbled himself to share in our humanity." And we all know what sharing in Christ's humanity looks and feels like, but have we considered what it might be like to share in Christ's divinity amid the highs and lows of this life? For James, John, and Peter, contemplating sharing in the divinity of Christ was almost too much to bear. Remember, they lived under Roman occupation. They were on a first-name basis with brokenness. The juxtaposition of this mountaintop experience with their own lived experience was stark. Hence, they had to shield their eyes. If you've ever gone to a midday movie, you know what it's like to emerge back into the light of day after being in a world of the dark theater. It's almost too much to bear. You have to shield and avert your eyes to readjust to this new reality. And as Rowan Williams wrote, the apostles in the icon are shielding their eyes because what they see is not easily manageable in their existing world. They are not ready to see with and in the light of God any more than we are. And this fantastic, incomprehensible moment of the Transfiguration opened up galaxies of new possibilities. This is what mountaintop experiences do. We've all had them. They expand our vision of what's possible. Our imaginations are opened up in new ways. And this mountaintop experience couldn't have come at a better time for the disciples, for we know what comes next in the story of Christ. After this mountaintop experience, the disciples will follow Christ off the mountain and into the valley of Holy Week. The disciples will need to recall this picture of Jesus transfigured on the Mount of the Transfiguration as they prepare to see him crucified on Mount Calvary. This is why we hear the story of the Transfiguration the Sunday before Lent begins every single year. Because Lent begins between two mountaintops, the Mount of the Transfiguration and Mount Calvary. And on these two mountaintops, the two bookends of Lent, we see two pictures of Jesus. These two pictures of Jesus are a photo negative of one another. To see Jesus transfigured is to see Jesus on the cross. To see Jesus on the cross is to see Jesus transfigured. And in our life of faith, as we know our own realities, we see both images of Jesus time and time again. Isn't this true for our lives of faith? Think about that with me. Amid all the glory and pain we may face, we are invited to see our lives taken up into this transfiguration story. On our earthly pilgrimage, we travel between our own Mount of the Transfiguration and Mount Calvary. We will experience moments of glory and moments of bereavement. Until we experience our own final resurrection, we are given this image of the Transfiguration as a reminder that amid the brokenness of this life, God's light will shine through us and sustain us. God's light will hold together and reflect something of God's original intention for our lives amid our own disquietude of our world. I'll never forget when I encountered the transfigured Christ for the first time. I was on a pastoral call. I was visiting a 93-year-old woman named Letty. She had just had a fall and broke her head and had surgery, and she was recovering at home where she lived with her son and family. And during this visit, Letty shared about how difficult her recovery was, because at 93, it's challenging to recover from a hip surgery, let alone any age. As we finished up our visit and I headed to the door, I noticed this big, beautiful grand piano, and I asked her who played. And immediately she said, "I do." Immediately she got up slowly from her chair and with her walker went over to the grand piano, sat herself down and began playing a rousing piece of music. And I encountered a totally different person, the energy that just infused through her bones, the glow that she had as she was playing was as though she had been changed, as though she had been transfigured. And when she was finished, she turned to me and said, "Come again?" To witness the transfigured Christ is to witness a person fully alive. St. Irenaeus has that famous line, "The glory of God is the human being fully alive." What makes you fully alive? It does not mean ignoring our humanity, our fragility, but to see God's light illumine even the broken pieces of our lives. It means that in our darkness, in our humanity, in our fragility, there is room for God's light, and it is almost too much to bear. About 2 years ago, on Valentine's Day, my two sisters warned me that my dad was going to call and to get the box of tissues ready. You see, about 10 years ago, my dad suffered a massive stroke. And one result of that stroke is that he has aphasia. He has difficulty speaking, and many of you here have met him and got to experience my father. And the great thing about my father, the impact, is that he can still sing. And since I was old enough to have a cell phone, and in those days it's when I went to college, he'd call me and he would sing Stevie Wonder's "I Just Called to Say I Love You." I have to tell you, as a young person, it got on my nerves. Until he stopped calling those first 8 years of his stroke and didn't. Well, he recalled this tradition and worked months on learning how to sing this song. And one Valentine's Day, 2 years ago, he called me, and of course, he sang this song to myself and my two older sisters. In my father's singing, the light of Christ shone through his fragility, and it was almost too much for me to bear. How have you encountered the transfigured Christ? How might you view the story of your own life in both fragility and beauty as the story of the transfiguration? In this transfiguration, may we be delivered from the disquietudes of our world so that we can behold Christ in his beauty, even when it means allowing God's light to piece back together the brokenness of our lives with God's power and glory. Amen. Please stand in body or in spirit. Let us say together the Nicene Creed found on page 358.
We believe in one God,
the Father,
the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of the one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please join me in the prayers of the people. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our bishop and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those serving our country, and particularly for Nicholas Amerson, Ryan Brown, Christopher and Teresa Beats, Andrew Burke, Eric Collinsworth, Will Early, Alexander Frank, Justin and Kristen Hodge, Tom Moore, Din Snyder, Michael and Elizabeth Sheldon, and Kirsten Weller. Let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and the suffering, the aged and the infirm, the refugee and the prisoner, for those in need of any kind of healing, and particularly for Alan, Dan, Bill, Millie, Michelle, Cecile, Angie, Bruce, Jim, Glenn, Miles, Lisa, Mark, Ken, Georgia, Blythe, Krista, Shelby, Jan, Tom, Todd, Doug, Scott, and the victims of gun violence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those grieving the loss of a loved one, their job, their health, or their old way of life, and particularly for Connie Kirby and family, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, especially Vita Holloway, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those celebrating God's goodness in their life through a birthday, an anniversary, or a life event, and particularly for birthdays, Jan Blankenship, Calvin Van Arsdal, and Roisin McEwen, let us pray to the Lord.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Turning to page 360. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you.
In thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole hearts, we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Please be seated.
Until we decided to play it today. listening to the words of the first verse, it's kind of cool. That would be cool. Because it contains the language about the light. And so listen for that. But the interesting thing is, for me, is that I thought somebody else wrote this. It is in our hymnal. It's number 8 in our hymnal. So when you circle back at the end to the first verse again, if you'd like to sing along, if you'd like to, if you're new, the hymnal's that red one.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them spring. Fresh from the Word. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Sun light, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's all play. Praise for elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the Word.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world on the night in which he was handed over to suffering and death. Our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God. All are welcome to receive the Eucharist at this time. If you'd like to receive the Eucharist in one kind, simply receive the body of Christ, the bread. If you'd like for it to be intinct on your behalf, please give your bread, the Eucharist, to one of our chalice ministers.
Thank you.
Our service continues on page 365. Page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted
us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated for the announcements. If you have an announcement to make, I invite you to come forward to the front and share your announcement at this time.
Morning. Just a shout out quick for the Graceful Cafe Community Breakfast on Saturday the 3rd. We had a few glitches in the beginning of the week with the sign-up, but then Tara repaired the link, and so it's back up and running. So we only had a couple people were, some people were not able to get in, but I want to let you know you can now. It's on the weekly update underneath the Graceful Cafe announcement, and I hope to see a lot of your faces there. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm happy to report on the sewer repair fundraiser that St. Gregory's, the congregation of St. Gregory's, contributed $38,000, and the two regions, Front Range and High Plains region, donated another $10,000 for a total of $48,000, which I think is going to get the job done. So thank you very much.
Good morning again. It's back to school time, as you may be aware, and you know what that means here. It's time for us to step forward and do everything we can to help our neighborhood school, Columbine Hills Elementary, which is only 1.3 miles away. We started a relationship with them about 3 years ago with Mother Liz. And our goal is always just to make sure that it has all the supplies the kids need to succeed. And unfortunately, many families find themselves using money budgeted for their food on the many things that students are asked to bring to school at the start of the year. And that's where our outreach committee can make a huge difference. So for the next 2 weeks, we will be collecting school supplies again for Columbine Hills. And this year they've asked us to focus on the supplies the parents often can't provide. Those include 3-ring binders, pocket folders, headphones, and dry eraser markers. There's a list in the bulletin. So please bring your supplies to the church or drop them by the office. And even if you don't have kids in school anymore, it's kind of fun to go back and go through the shelves at Target and pick out the 3-ring binders and whatnot and round up the stuff that our kids no longer have to deal with, but others do. So thank you for your generosity.
I'll come talk with here up here so everybody can hear me. Notice the pretty flowers that we have. Those are all from our community garden, so thank you for all the gardeners who take care of that, weed it, take care of it for us to be able to use. So we use these flowers from about the end of May, clear through till after the first freeze. So. What I'm asking, though, is we have a couple of people who are rolling off of the Flower Guild. We'd love to have anybody who wants to join us. Please do. It's about once a month or once every 6 weeks. We always pair people with another person. So if you're newer to it, it's not hard to do. It's just a matter of about 1 hour on a Saturday morning. We either buy flowers at King Supers or we pick flowers from the garden. So talk to me if you'd like to join us. It's very fun. Thank you.
Please stand. You were transfigured on the mountain, O Christ God, showing your disciples as much of your glory as they could hold. Let your eternal light shine also upon us, O giver of light, so we may be a light in our world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you now and forevermore. Amen. The love, hope, and comfort of Jesus Christ to our world. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.